morning.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody.
Yeah.
Do you have any questions or reports?
Alan does. Got a pledge before ready?
Gonna start a new job in a week or so, whenever that comes around.
Good deal.
Something fun for a change.
Anybody else?
I would praise the doctor, said my hip was fine when I failed, he was surprised I didn't, but it's just fine to get x-rays.
Awesome.
It's gotta heal up a little more, you know, kinda set it back a little bit, all that weight going on that concrete floor. So maybe getting my knee done, we gotta figure out when. I got a new grandbaby coming, great grandbaby coming December, after Christmas or the first of January, so I gotta wait till after that.
Anybody else?
Thank God for another day.
Yes.
Thank him for his foundation.
I'm thankful for bills as well as I do.
I'm glad that they found out what's been going on with drones, I'm glad they didn't get that taken care of. Anybody have any prayer requests?
Friend of mine has, that I work with, has COVID, so just encouraging prayers. He's having just mild symptoms, so that's good, just sinuses and no fever or anything so far, so.
Hopefully it just stays like that.
I hope so. And her husband was gonna get tested, but I never heard. Yeah, from the Rick Stahl. He's a friend of ours that was diagnosed a few months ago with lung cancer, and he was tested positive yesterday for COVID. So they admitted him immediately. Same with his, we can experience that God's healing quickly with this.
My granddaughter Hannah is in bad shapes. Her mother's getting ready to kick her out into the streets. She needs a touch, big touch.
Yes.
Deliverance.
Deliverance from the addiction.
I don't know if it's just the older I don't know if it's just the older I get, the more I look around, but it just seems like there's so much deception in the world today, that people are a lot of times willing, but are just completely deceived by so many things in this world right now.
Yes.
There's like a spirit of darkness.
Yes.
That has just blinded so many people, and they don't realize that they're walking around in the darkness.
Anybody else? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us through this week, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you for blessing us with your health. We ask, Lord, that you clear lungs, Lord, and deliver people from the virus that's been going around against you.
Yes, we agree.
Return their strength to them, Lord. Boost their immunity. We also ask, Lord, that you deliver Hannah, Lord, as well as other people who need your deliverance, Lord, from whatever they're facing in their lives. We ask that you intervene and strengthen them, Lord, and strength they need. Give them the clarity of mind to realize that they need to make a change for the better. We also lift up our country to you, Lord, and our government. And we ask that you please protect our military, Lord, and our
just have a couple of things I want to bring your, to your attention today. It is at that time of year, we'd like to decorate the church for the Christmas holidays coming up. And we're gonna try to do that this Saturday at 10 o'clock. If you're available and you'd like to join us, that'd be great. Appreciate all the help. We've got some things put outside and things inside here, and we just wanna make it look joyful and peaceful and ready for the holidays. It's always such a good feeling to get that done. Afterwards, we take it down, it just doesn't feel quite right. But for a few weeks anyway, we're gonna have it all looking real good. So if you can be here Saturday at 10, we'll be here to do that. The other thing I'd like to make you aware of is once a month, we try to have a emphasis on the missions.
Yes.
That's something that's very important to the Assemblies of God Church. It's one of their strengths. It's the middle of the month now, we haven't done that yet, so we're gonna do that today. Some of the missionaries that we support on a regular monthly basis have been here. You've met them in person. Some of them I've met before at a different church. Some of the missionaries that we support, I don't know who they are. I've never actually met them. But they're all doing an important work.
Yes.
We are supporting them, and they count on that support. So I encourage you to give to missions when you can. I encourage you to pray for our missionaries. I want to read a list here of those that we support. Also, when you have time, in the back there by the table, there are pictures and information on some of the missionaries and where they're at and the work that they're doing. When you have time, I like to look at those from time to time and just kind of remind me of what's going on in other countries and the important work that is being done. We like to have missionaries in here from time to time, and we haven't been able to do that much this year because of the restrictions, but hopefully we can do that again sometime. A lot of them, after spending years in other countries, they do come back to the U.S. They raise more support, they go to various churches, and they like to come and tell us in person what they're doing, what the needs are. It's nice to have that personal relationship with them. But the missionaries that we support, whether you've met them or not, they are important to the church, and we want to pray for them and the work that they're doing. We support on a monthly basis Stuart Brown, Gary Ellison, Rossin Farhood, David Johnson, Jason Morrison, Bernie Smith. We've also had Candace Couser here at our church. We did support her on a one-time basis. And Chris Stubbs, we also have supported him. So just keep them in your prayers and support them the best that you can. Thank you.
Tells me that we are not an island. We are not our own little
just like Betty's granddaughter. She's hurting, she's in turmoil, she needs prayer. So we as a family of God should stand around Betty and pray not only for Betty, just to give her strength and words and wisdom, maybe to speak life into that situation, but pray for the granddaughter, that God will touch her and woo her and bring her in and deliver her.
Yes.
And when that happens, I'm not saying if it happens, I'm saying when it happens, because I'm calling the things that aren't as though they are.
Come on.
Amen.
Glory.
So when that happens, we will celebrate, we will be joyful as a family. We will be joyful for everyone, whatever you've got going on in your lives today. Just know that we are a family.
Come on. Yes.
And we're here together to support you and to lift you up and to be a family. So when technology works, it's a wonderful thing.
Yes.
When we were on our way over to work to church this morning, Doug said, "Oh look, there's a rainbow." And it was pretty. It kind of disappeared into the clouds, but it was still pretty. You know, and it reminded me of God's promises.
Yes.
His promises are yes and amen.
Yes.
They never fail.
Declaring the word of the Lord. I'm thankful that the fire came back on. Although we could have went on ahead and worshiped the Lord with it all too, amen?
Yes.
I mean, our worshiping the Lord doesn't depend on whether or not we have electricity. I just think that the power of God is still real. Amen. If the electricity power is off, God's power is still real.
Yes.
Amen. And so I want to just give you an opportunity. Linda was talking about the family of God. And so I like that concept. And you hear that quite a bit here about the family of God and the importance of the family of God. And so we want to just give you, as part of the family of God, the opportunity to share if God put something on your heart, or if you maybe this week you was reading in the scripture, or something just came to your mind, or whatever that you would like to share. We want to give you an opportunity to do that. And so, anybody got anything on their heart? Amen. We don't want you to be shy. One thing about brothers and sisters, they're not shy to talk to each other.
Don't hold back, yeah.
So we want to just give you the opportunity, if you feel something on your heart, to go ahead and share it with us. I will go ahead, Michelle.
Just remind it that during this time, a lot of people have just lost hope in a lot of things.
Yes.
But as Christians, we can sometimes get overwhelmed too with everything that's going on.
Yes.
But just take opportunity for all the small moments to share hope with people around you.
Yes. Knows we ought to always have hope in the Lord. And that brings me back to, weekly I've been encouraging you as we begin service to invite the Lord to take his place of honor. Did you do that today? Amen. You say, Pastor, why do you keep bringing that up? I think it's one of the most important things in the church for the Lord to have his place of honor. And so we want to just keep encouraging you, not only in the service, but even in your daily walk with God, to invite him to have his place of honor in your life. And the other thing is, I thought about this morning. We don't talk about this a lot, but we want to try to keep this in your mind also, and that is to, Sunday mornings ought to be a special time to come into the house of the Lord and have the presence of God, and we have the promise that God is with us. He said, where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst. So we believe God's here this morning. We believe he's present. One of the things that I think about a lot, and we just want to kind of bring this to your mind, is that when we come to church and we begin to have service, we ought to put everything that happened last week out of our minds, everything that we're looking for that's going to happen this week, let's kind of try to put that out of our minds, and just have one thing on our mind when we're here in church, and that's to lift up the Lord, to have his place of honor. And so we want to just kind of encourage you in them two things: to one, to invite him to take his place of honor, and the other thing is to try to put everything out of our mind and be in tune with God the best of our ability. And I know that at times people come into church with a heavy heart, with problems. Sometimes people come in rejoicing, and that's good. But for those of you that hope that you go out today from church being encouraged, and that you know you, that you've been in the presence of God, that, that somehow today maybe you came in carrying a heavy load, struggling maybe to carry that load, and we hope when you go out that you will have a spring in your step, and you will have the knowledge and the understanding that God is with you, and that whatever you face, God and you can face it together. Amen. So we just want to kind of encourage you in them things, and I mean, you know, sometimes we need to be reminded about things like that. Amen. Sometimes the problems can get so heavy that we can't see, I guess this wasn't part of my plans this morning, but I'll share this with you. I've shared this with you before, but I feel like maybe it's a time to share it again. Back, this happened years and years and years ago, but one time I could see myself as a soldier, and I had this gun, and I was fighting the enemy, shooting at him and stuff, you know, and I just got to kind of look at this in the spirit realm. This is, takes a little imagination, I guess, but you know, all of a sudden I looked, and the enemy just seemed like it was everywhere. And I thought, boy, I got to get out of here. They're going to get me. And so I looked behind me to, you know, because I was going to run that away. And looked behind me, and like all, everything was desolate behind me. There was no place to hide, and, you know, wasn't no place to go to for protection. And so finally, I thought, you know what, I can't go back. If I go back, I'm gonna, you know, there's no place back there for me, no protection. And so I looked forward, and I saw like the enemy was in the valley, but the next hill was clear. And I thought, you know what, if we just get through the valley, we'll be on the mountaintop, amen? And that's clear over there. So it's like a jump back down that foxhole and start fighting that much harder. I want to say to you, church, sometimes in your walk with God, there's no place to go back to. All that stuff back there is death. It wasn't no good when you was back there. There's no protection back there. So, you know, sometimes we feel that we're going to turn around sometimes, don't we? It looks pretty discouraging to think, but I want you to know there's no place to turn around with God. It's always yea and amen with the Lord. And I was thinking this morning about the woman that had the little issue of blood, and she'd spent all that she had, and she didn't have no hope anymore, but she said to herself, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. Woo! Hallelujah this morning. Maybe you are in that place like that little woman that didn't have any hope. And if you could just touch his, the hem of his garment this morning, how many knows you could go out of here healed? You could go out of here encouraged. You could go out of here saying, I can face tomorrow because he lives, because he's in my life, because I know that he's real. I can face tomorrow, and I can see, and all these things. How many knows? Listen to me this morning, church. I'm preaching to you. The Bible says that he has not given you the spirit of fear. And yet sometimes fear is real in our life. Amen. Where did that come from? It didn't come from God. Amen. Can I tell you this morning, if you've come in here fearful of something that you're facing, can I tell you that that fear is not coming from God? The Bible plainly states, I have not given you a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. Or in other words, a victory. There was a time in my life when I used to walk around singing a little chorus, "Victory, victory shall be mine. If I hold my peace and let the Lord fight my battles, victory, victory shall be mine." And I would just walk around singing that to myself because you know what? I needed victory. Amen. I needed victory. And it looked impossible. But with just that little song or that little chorus, it could do something inside of you. You know, there could be hope instead of hopelessness. Amen. Can I tell you this morning? The only difference between discourage and courage is to this. Amen? Think about it. The only difference between discourage and courage, the word, is the this. So if you're discouraged, get rid of the this and have courage. Now, I know this all sounds simple. Can I tell you, the Bible says that it is a simple way. That it doesn't take a real smart man to figure it all out. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad?
Yes.
For that? Yes. I'm not a real smart man. But I don't have to be smart to figure out that God is the equalizer. Whew. God is the equalizer.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Sometimes I'm weak.
Thank you, God.
How many know what the Bible said? When I'm weak, and God is strong.
Woo.
Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. These are simple words this morning. But I'm telling you, God is not a complicated God.
No.
He's not a God that it takes somebody with a real high IQ to figure this all out. In fact, it matters. You can have the highest IQ in the world and still not figure out the things about God, about the kingdom of God. How many knows God's kingdom is not of this world?
Thank you.
Hallelujah. The kingdom of God is not of this world. It's a spirit kingdom. Can you understand all that? How can you figure all that out? I can't. I just got to believe and have faith. How many know the Bible said that for Abraham, it, because he had faith, it was counted unto him as righteousness.
Yes, Lord.
Because he had faith.
Yes, Lord.
And so sometimes, church, when we was running around, I had some buddies. They was all pretty good size. When I was a senior in high school, I weighed 225, 230. And all my buddies was about the same size I was. And we had this saying, we'd say, when the going gets tough, the rough get going. Amen? When the going gets tough, the rough get going. Or can we say today, when the going gets tough, get your faith in God. Let it walk with you. Let it talk with you. Let it lead you. I've said many times, the Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. Listen, if you understood everything, if you knew everything there was to know, it wouldn't take no faith. Amen? You would know. You would understand. You would be enlightened, if you will. But because we don't understand everything, because we don't know everything, that's why we have to have faith. And how many know sometimes you just have to walk by faith? Amen. I may not know how God's going to work this out. I may not know that he's going to open the Red Sea and make a way for us to go through. But I have to have faith. but somehow he's with us. If I perish, I may know he's still God.
Yes.
Yes, he's still God if I perish. If this thing would take me down, he's still God. About time getting my message in it. We're going to go to Luke this morning and read some scripture. And we're going to talk somewhat about the kingdom of God. We may, I'm not sure about this yet, but we may spend a little time here. How many knows we need to talk about the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? Well, let's go ahead and read some scripture and then we'll get into the word. Chapter 10, verse 1, we'll start there. I think we finished up last week with chapter, or was it last week or the week before with chapter 9? After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his kingdom." I'm sorry, I might have got out of the line. "Ask the Lord of harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or a bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say peace to this house. If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there eating and drinking whatever they have given you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcome, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and are not welcome, go into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you.' Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has came near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Woe unto you, Corinth! Woe unto you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will be lifted to the heavens. No, you will go down to Hades. Whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects me, whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me." Father, we thank you for this word. We ask you today that you would be with us with your anointing, Father, that you would use me to speak to this church, Father, that you would use this body to speak to us, Father. We ask for your presence. We ask for your anointing. We ask that the word comes alive today and pricks our hearts and you reveal yourself to us in the mighty name of Jesus. Okay, we're talking today about, he said the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. I was thinking today as we begin to read the scriptures. Now, I just want to say to you, if at any time during this service, if you feel an unction in your spirit to share something, get my attention and we'll let you share with us what you feel in the spirit. I believe, like I said, I believe in the body of Christ, and I believe in listening to the body of Christ. But Jesus is telling them about going out into the world and winning the world for Christ, if you will. And I began to think about this. You know, in the church world today, we have, not so much our church because we're a little country church, but a lot of churches, they have all kinds of programs. You know, they got this program, they got that program, they're going to do this, that's going to reach the lost, they're going to do that, that's going to reach the lost. They got all these programs, and yet somehow, we're not really reaching the lost, are we? And so I just begin to wonder about that. You know, why are we not really reaching the people in the world? And I know that there's a certain, it's dependent on people themselves also. They got to be willing to accept God. But somehow, we as a church need to be reaching people, our families, our children, our neighbors, those that we rub shoulders with at work. And yet, somehow we don't seem to be doing that. I know we do somewhat. Did you have something, Linda? I thought you had your hand. I know somewhat, you know, we do see a certain amount of people coming to Christ sometimes. And, years ago they used to have great revivals and people would accept the Lord and come to God. It don't seem like we see that as much anymore as we used to. And I think, quite honestly, when we begin to look at the world today, there is a certain amount of people that really don't want anything to do with God. Amen? Am I being honest? There's a certain amount of people that just don't even want to hear about it. They don't want to, if you start talking about God to them, they're going to tell you they don't want to hear about it, that they don't want you talking about it. I've had people tell me that, hey, I don't want to hear about that. And some people will, out of respect, I guess they'll listen to you, but they really don't want to hear it, but they let you talk anyways. But how are we to reach the lost? I know it takes a certain amount of the Spirit of God to move in people's lives. The Bible said that you can't even come to the Lord unless the Lord's drawing you. So I know that it takes, a move in the Holy Spirit, if you will, to cause people to begin to have a hunger for God, or to have a hunger for the things of God, you might say it like that. And the other thing is, you know, we as people that have accepted Christ, we shouldn't be so proud that we think that we've attained something. We should be thankful that the Lord drew us to Him. You know, it wasn't because I was a good person that I accepted the Lord. It wasn't because I was the only reason I can say that I came to the Lord was because God had mercy on me and He was drawing me to Him. And so I can't brag or feel like I've attained something, other than, I'm thankful that God had mercy on me. I'm thankful that He drew me by His Spirit. And I'm thankful that He draws other people. So we're talking about the kingdom of God. That's what we're really talking about, isn't it? And is In the scripture, it plainly talks about that, that his kingdom is not of this world. Amen?
Yes.
So that's where a lot of us have trouble accepting what God is doing for us, because his kingdom is not of this world. It's of a different, his kingdom is a different kingdom than what is worldly kingdom that we see today and that a lot of people operate in today. And a lot of people never really ever give it much thought that there's also another kingdom, which is the kingdom of God. And so sometimes I think the church even forgets that, that there's actually two kingdoms. There's the kingdom of this world, but there's also the God's kingdom. And so let's go ahead and maybe read some scriptures. Hopefully we can shed a little bit of light on this. I want to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And this is, this does not tell us what the kingdom of God is, but it tells us what it's not. Amen? I mean, though, sometimes we can learn more about something when we learn of what it's not as to what it is. So we want to read some scripture here, and it will, want to start at verse, chapter 6, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and we'll start at verse 7. The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means you have been completely defeated already. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your brothers and sisters. Or do you not know that the wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral or idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And that is what some of you were, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. So all these things that we read there, that he says that this is not the kingdom of God. Do you not know that the wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor the idolaters, nor the adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. So all these things that we've read there, those are the things that will keep us, if you will, from entering the kingdom of God. Or you can say it like this, those are not of the kingdom of God. Now, I want to say this to you today. I didn't read this to be a somebody with a stick beating somebody over the head with it and say, well, you're not gonna get into the kingdom of God if you're doing this, because if you go down and through the scriptures, it said that we were all doing some of these things. Amen? Let's go ahead and go down there and we'll read. And that is what some of you were. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. The scripture declares that all have sinned and came short of the glory of God. So we've all been in a place where we was not of the kingdom of God, if you will. I mean, that's why in John chapter 3, Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. In other words, Nicodemus, you're in this world, but if you want to get into the kingdom of God, you have to be born again. You have to have a new birth. Nicodemus doesn't understand it. He said, how can I go into my mother's womb and be born again? And Jesus is saying, no, Nicodemus, that's not what we're talking about. The kingdom of God is not the same as the kingdom of this world. Amen? The kingdom of God is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of this world is the kingdom of this world. Let me know what the Bible says. You are in the world, but not of the world. Amen? Let me know that we're in this world. But if we've had the new birth, if we've had that experience with God that we are born again, then we may be in this world yet, but we're also in a different kingdom. We're birthed into a different kingdom. Now, I'd venture to say to you that very few people in the church really understand that. But most of them are just running around, you know, well, they don't even think about it. You know, they're just part of the world. But they go to church. Amen? So then because they go to church, they think everything's all right. Well, can I tell you this? And I don't mean to be rude or obnoxious or anything like that. But I have to tell you, if you go to church every day, but you've never been born again, you're really not of the kingdom of God. You're still of this worldly kingdom. And then, like I said, I'm not saying that to be obnoxious or angry or beating you over the head with a stick, but I want to tell you the truth. There are two kingdoms. There is this worldly kingdom, and there is the heavenly kingdom, or if you will, the kingdom that we are born. Now, just to kind of clarify this, why do we have to have the new birth? Why is that so important? In this world, our natural birth, we was born of our father and mother. Amen. They had a union, and you were the result of that union. That is from the first man, Adam. That union. Remember, Adam had a union with Eve, and she conceived, had children. That's the first man, Adam. The second man, Adam, was Jesus. And so when we have this relationship and we are born again, now, the Bible talks about us being conceived in sin because the first man, Adam, was sinful. Amen? How many know Adam and Eve, they sinned. They were sinful. And so their, if you will, their offspring inherited their sinful nature. Am I making this plain this morning?
Yes.
That the offspring of my mother and my father, which is me, because they were sinful, I am sinful. Amen? In this world. But now when we have the new birth, and we are born again, I mean, it was our father, which is God, did not sin, cannot sin, will not sin. And so when we're birthed of him in the spirit realm, if you will, or the heavenly kingdom, if we want to say it like that, that makes us pure and clean because we was birthed from a pure and clean source. I hope we can, I know I'm taking a little time this morning to kind of explain that, and some of you may understand that, but there may be others that don't, and so so we want you to understand how many knows that the Bible said that flesh and blood will not enter into the kingdom of God. And the reason that it won't enter into the kingdom of God is because of the sinful nature of flesh and blood. It was, you were shaped in iniquity, you were born in iniquity, you was born of the first man, Adam, and there is no way, because he was born of a sinful nature, there is no way that you could ever clean up the sinful flesh enough for it to be a heavenly body. Amen? So then, if flesh and blood is not going to go to the kingdom, or go to heaven, or be in the heavenly kingdom, then how are we going to get into the heavenly kingdom? That's why Jesus was telling Nicodemus, you must be born again. In other words, you must have this new birth that is pure, undefiled, that, how many knows that that's why now, the Bible says now, we can go boldly before the Father and make our petitions known, and the reason it is because of that second birth, if you will, that Jesus was talking about when he said you must be born again of the water and of the Spirit. So when we are born of the water and of the Spirit, then we were birthed into the heavenly kingdom. And how many knows that that birth, that heavenly or spirit body, however you want to say it, heavenly body, spirit body, it can never sin because it's pure. It's born of God. How many knows if it's born of God, it cannot sin because there was no sin ever in there. So how are you going to inherit from God a sinful nature? It can't be done. You are inheriting from God his righteousness, his righteous nature, his sinless nature. That's what we're inheriting from God, and that's why it's so important for us to be born again. Yes. It's the only, let me say it this way, it's the only way I can be saved. Yes. Is to have a new birth. Yes. There's no other way that I can be saved, because there's no other way that I can be pure enough to go before the Lord. There's no other way that I can be bold enough to go before the Lord and make my petitions known, except that I've had the new birth, and now I'm in a new kingdom, if you will. And then when it really gets confusing, is we're still in the world. We're still in the world. We still walk in this sinful body. How many know this sinful body still has sinful desires? And I would even go so far as to say this, there's times when we may even allow this sinful body to do sinful things. You remember the scripture says therefore it's no more I that sinneth, but sin that dwell in me. You see, the new man, the one that was born again through God, it cannot sin, it will not sin. That's why Paul was saying, it's no more I that doeth it. You see, I've had this new birth. My new man is not the one that's sinning. It's the old man. So we want to just, when we're talking about the kingdom of God, how many knows that somehow we need to allow people to know these truths? Amen? Yes. They need to know these truths.
Yes.
And you know why? Because if they don't know this truth, they're going to wake up some morning and be condemned. You can't live for God. Look how you're living. Amen? Anybody relate to that? That's when you have to say, but I've had a new birth. See, I've had a new birth. Ooh, glory.
Yes.
I've had a new birth.
Thank you.
I'm no longer of that sinful nature. Yeah, I'm still walking in that body.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I'm still on this earth. I'm still walking on this same earth that everybody else is walking on. But I've had a new birth.
Yes.
I've been born again.
Yes.
I have a relationship with God. I'm in a different kingdom now. I'm not up that old kingdom.
Yes.
My old man is still there. Amen?
Yes.
My old man is still there.
Yes.
But my new man will never be there.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Because it cannot be, because it's not of that kingdom.
Thank you.
Do you understand that? It's not of that kingdom.
Thank you, God.
I want to read probably just one more scripture, and then we'll probably go ahead and close. We don't want to take too much time. Let's go to St. John, chapter 18.
What chapter again?
St. John, chapter 18. And we're going to start at verse 36. St. John, chapter 18, and verse 36. This is Pilate. Am I a Jew? Pilate replied. Your own people and chief priests handed you over. What is it you have done? Now listen. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now, my kingdom is from another place. You are a king then, said Pilate. Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Jesus was saying to Pilate, he said, my kingdom is not of this world. How many think that Pilate understood what he was saying? I figure Pilate's up there, Jesus, what are you talking about?
No, he didn't understand.
You know, I can't understand what you're talking about. You're talking to, you're not of this kingdom. Hey, I'm Pilate. I'm sitting on this judgment seat. You're in my court. Now, what do you say? Your kingdom's not of this world. But how many knows it wasn't of this world? You see, Pilate had no, if you will, let me say this morning. Pilate had no power over God. Jesus was subjecting himself to Pilate because his kingdom was not of this world. And he was making a way for his kingdom, if you will, to blossom. He was making a way for you and I to be in that kingdom, that we could go boldly to the Father and have fellowship with him now. I mean, this wasn't possible until Jesus went to the cross.
Thank you.
Amen?
Amen.
It wasn't possible. But when Jesus went to the cross and he shed his blood and he died oh man, I'm having a hard time stopping this morning.
Preach it.
The Bible declares that if the devil had known about the kingdom of God and how Jesus was going to open up this kingdom for people, they would have never crucified Jesus.
Thank you.
Amen?
Amen?
The devil would never have allowed Jesus to be crucified if he had known about the kingdom of God and what was going to happen when Jesus shed his blood and how he was going to open up, if you will, the kingdom of God for everyone that would accept what he done on the cross,
yes,
to come boldly before the Father and begin to say, hey, I'm in this kingdom.
Yes.
Woo, glory. They wouldn't have allowed Jesus to die.
Thank you, Lord.
But Jesus knew And his kingdom was not of this world. In other words, he wasn't setting himself up as a king over Jerusalem. He was setting himself up, if you will, I must say it like this, as the king of the ones that accept him.
Yes.
Are saved of him. I'm not sure that I'm using the right words here. But I'm hoping you're understanding that he was not setting up his kingdom. He was setting up, if you will, God's kingdom.
Yes.
He himself was a man. How many knows that Jesus could have called legions?
Yes.
Legions of angels to come and defend him. And keep him from going to the cross. He could have. But he didn't. Because he knew that that was the way that he was opening it up for his kingdom, for God's kingdom. Also would be so that people would be of this world but not in this world. In other words, just like Jesus, his kingdom was not of this world. His kingdom was of God's kingdom. We're going to have to stop there. Father, we thank you, we praise you for your son Jesus coming to this world as a man and how he overcame, Father, that he did not sin. But he was the perfect sacrifice so that now we can be born again of your kingdom, Father. Now we can go boldly before you. Now the Bible declares there is therefore no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. And so we thank you for that, Father. We appreciate that. And God, I pray today that you would go with each and every one. And that, Father, you would just be with them this week as they go through their lives, no matter what they're facing, no matter what they're looking at in their life, Father, that you would just be with them and that you would somehow cause the spirit of faith to rise up in us, Father, that we would just look to you, the author and the finisher of our faith, that no longer would we be fearful of what this world has to present to us, but that we would be at peace with you, Father, in perfect peace, knowing that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and that all is well in your kingdom.
Yes.
In your name, amen.